So while Robert is taking care of the music, I want to kind of put out, Bill, you've been to workshops, Justin's been to workshops, Robert's been to workshops. You three are relatively new faces to me. Does anyone here have any idea of what neurolinguistic programming, shortened to NLP, is? You do have an idea. Robert knows. And so I'm going to be kind of talking to you guys real quickly.
No, I know everything.
Okay, so neurolinguistic programming, just so everyone's clear, is a technology that was invented by Bandler and Grinder. They were two guys out from the West Coast, and they created this technology based upon their comprehension and understanding of computer programming and language. One of them was a linguist, the other one was a computer and mathematics guy, and together they came up with this technology that's called neurolinguistic programming. And what they did was they analyzed a very famous therapist, from cognitive behavioral therapist to gestalt therapy, and it was psychiatrists that were dealing with people on camera, and the ones who would have the biggest effect, where the client said that they had the biggest change, they tried to model those techniques, and out of that they were able to create these language patterns. So what we do in neurolinguistics is we combine body language and language to create new beliefs and behaviors. And that's really what you're doing, is you're trying to find and model behaviors and beliefs that are successful and produce the most optimized outputs, outcomes for your life. So the first thing you have to be able to do is you have to be able to create well-defined outcomes, okay? So can anyone think of an outcome or a situation that you've had in your life, in a relationship or a business dealing, where the outcome was not ideal? Mm-hmm. It did not go well.
Absolutely.
Right, so everyone here can pretty much think of one of those. Can you think of a situation or a circumstance when everything went perfect? When it went just right?
We got married.
See there? There you go. Now, most of the time, we don't know why that happens. Most of the time, we go through life and kind of don't know why some things work out, and sometimes they don't. However, if you start to look at patterns and you start to really analyze the behaviors that you do that create more successful outcomes, you will start to identify that you probably have methods that create success in your behavior, and you probably have methods that create failure. And these are things that we learn in our childhood, and that's why we talk about our behaviors and beliefs, okay? Is there anybody here that has changed their mind about something that they thought whenever they were a child, and they changed their mind and it helped them later on in life with their behavior? Does anybody want to share one of those? Because I have one that I can share. Bill, you got one?
Well, it's just procrastination.
Procrastination. So you kind of had a light come on that you were procrastinating and you needed to change that.
Well, after the 100th time that it produced a less than desirable optimal outcome, yes.
And then you were just like, that's got to change.
Yeah, and it's still a struggle because it's my natural inclination.
Right.
I have to force myself to be proactive rather than procrastinating.
Awesome, but you've decided that that's something that you want to do.
I have to.
Okay, great. So does anyone else have anything like that in their life, that they've, over time, they've realized that the way they were behaving was not getting them the best outcome and they wanted to change?
Wait, it'll happen. Don't jump into it too soon.
What, now say that again.
Okay. I'm a hurry up and wait.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
So don't jump into something too soon. See it through.
Good. Okay. Yeah. That's good. That's very good. So now, when did you make that decision? When did that change for you?
When I was 5 years old.
Okay.
I opened my Christmas present
and you learned that lesson real good, didn't you? Now, how did your parents make sure that you learned that?
Well, so they hope I enjoyed my gifts.
That was it.
Well,
they knew. Sure. Gotcha. Okay. So a lot of times, and what you'll start to see is that about the 100th time that we experience pain, the one time we experience pain, it's normally pain, right? Something hurts, and we decide, that's enough. I don't want to do that anymore, right? So what I do is I help people identify the patterns that they aren't aware of, the things that they don't see. So one time, whenever I was at Bible school, I was working late, and my roommate was out, and I came home, and when I came in, I saw him standing in his room, which I thought was unusual, because normally at 8:30, 9 o'clock at night, he was at his work. I was just kind of shocked that he was in his room. But the really weird thing was that he was standing in his room alone, and it was dark. And I just thought, you know, maybe the guy's praying or something. I'm not sure. So I went ahead and went into my room, and I took a shower, and I got out, and I started making myself dinner. And I thought to myself, I have not heard him move or do anything since I went in there. I better check on him. So I just yelled from the other room. He's like, hey, Chris, I'm making dinner. Do you want anything? And he didn't answer, and I just thought, wow, that's really weird. I looked over on the counter, and there was a note from Chris. And it said, hey man, I picked up a shift. I am working late this evening. I won't be in until after 10. Don't worry about it. So immediately in my brain, I went, who's in Chris's room? And who's been in there? So I ran into my bedroom full speed. I grabbed my bat and I ran into Chris's room and I reared back and I almost took one of his full-size posters out that was hanging up on his door. And it was, I don't know if you guys have ever seen the movie The Matrix, but it was Neo standing just like this. And so I thought that there was somebody in my house. And I was going to take this out with a bat. You guys, I went through at least 30 seconds of full-on panic and grabbed a bat and was about to tear a hole in a wall over something that wasn't real. Okay? And the majority of the things that we overreact to in life and the majority of the things that cause us real pain, anxiety, and worry aren't real and aren't ever going to happen. So what I do is I help people to see why we get this type of mentality. So what happened first? Why did I panic? What happened first? I got scared because I had seen something. So most of our visual cortex, hey, how's it going, man? Salads are here.
I got some of the salads.
Perfect.
Okay. Got two Caesars down. Two guys requested Caesars. The rest are all putting out as house salads.
Okay, great. Thank you very much.
No problem.
I'm just happy, Bill.
Sorry, it's just a little crazy right now.
No, you're fine, man. We appreciate everything you're doing for us.
Get some forks.
Yes, please do. Thank you.
I'll grab it.
Okay. Oh, I appreciate that. Thanks.
And napkins.
All right, so whenever we're talking about perceptions, can somebody read me that first paragraph? Because I want to talk about the eyes. And the reason that this is important is, and what I mean is by the first paragraph, I'm sorry, right after the V-A-K-O-G on the perceptions portion. We're going to talk about the eyes and why our eyes are something unique and special. Bill, would you mind reading that?
Sure. So even these points of contact are not what they seem. Take your eyes, for example, your windows of the world. Well, they're not really. Not windows at any rate, not even a camera. Have you ever wondered why a camera can never seem to capture the essence of the visual image that you see? The eyes are much more intelligent than a camera. The individual receptors, the rods, the cones of the retina, respond not to the light itself, but to the changes or differences in the light. Consider the apparently simple task of looking at one of these words. If you open your eye and the page were perfectly still, the word would still disappear as soon as each rod had fired its response to the initial black or white stimulus. In order to keep sending information about the shape of the letters, the eye flickers minutely and rapidly so that the rods at the boundary of the black and white continue being stimulated.
Awesome.
We can keep going?
Does anybody want to pick up from there?
In this way, we continue to see the letter. The image is projected upside down on the retina, coded into the electrical impulses by the rods and cones, and reassembled from these by the visual cortex of the brain. The resulting picture is then projected out there, but it is created deep inside the brain. In summation, we do literally see through the complex series of active perceptual filters.
So the pictures that we see are out there, are not out there, they're actually in here. They're in our brain. Our brain has to translate a bunch of electrical signals and a bunch of photons into a picture, into an image. So even what we see isn't actually what's out there. It is a translation of the light. And it's a very small window of the electromagnetic signal, of the electromagnetic wave. We only see right in between ultraviolet and infrared. That's it. There's like X-ray, gamma rays. It goes all the full spectrum. And our human eyes are not designed to survive to see all of those. We only need a really narrow window. So what we actually see isn't even what's out there. Now, that's just a scientific basis so that you understand that what the brain perceives is only what's necessary to your survival. That's all it needs to perceive. That's all it wants to perceive. So it only uses your visual, your auditory, your kinesthetic, your olfactory, and your gustatory, which is your sight, sound, smell, taste, touch. It only uses those five sensory inputs to create everything that you think you need to survive. Okay? And the number one is visual. So what we do with neurolinguistics is we access visual all of the time. We access visuals. Okay? It's a primary way that we connect others to what we want them to see. Now, with dating and romance, what you want others to see is what? What do you want your significant other to see when you're thinking romantically, when you're thinking about dating? What do you want them to see?
The good stuff.
The good stuff. That's right. Now, let me ask you something. Do I only have good stuff? No, I do not. I do not only have good stuff. I've got a mix, a bag of bad and good, right? Now, it doesn't matter what my good traits are. It matters what she thinks my good traits are. That's what matters, is whenever we're dealing with dating and romance, we have to extract, what is it that you're into? What is it that you like in a partner? That's what we're looking for whenever we are talking to someone else about their, whenever we're trying to put ourselves with that person, because dating and romance is just that, trying to find out, do I click with this person? Do I gel with this person? Well, the best way to do that is to begin to put yourself in that person's scenario. What do they see? Whenever they think of dating, when they think of love, when they think of happiness and contentment, what images come to their mind? What do they see? One of the fastest ways to get somebody to imagine something like that is to ask them to put themselves in that scenario and ask them a different question. Like this. Hey, let's say you and I, for whatever reason, we're in a hotel together and we were going to order room service. Would you get chocolate cake, strawberries, or warm honey? Warm honey. Okay, so now the way this works is that warm is the significant adjective. Warm is the one that she's going to cue on, okay? Now, I didn't actually put myself in a hotel room with her doing anything romantic, did I? I didn't, but I asked her to imagine we're there and ordering room service. Now, why do you think we'd be in a hotel room ordering room service?
Because you're hungry.
Because we're hungry, right? That's what you do. Now, what is that person going to automatically start to visualize? A hotel room, us ordering room service, and now I have to make a decision. So what I started realizing with neurolinguistics, and whenever you're connecting other people to whatever it is that you want them to see, whatever it is that you want them to envision, and you have to remember that this is kind of like sales. You're trying to identify whether or not you want to be with this person too. This isn't all one-sided where you're only trying to meet their needs. You're also trying to find out if the needs that they are looking for, that's you. Because the worst thing you can do is try to fit yourself into somebody else's visuals of what they think their ultimate dating relationship would be, and then find out that you pretzeled yourself into a relationship that you're miserable in. So you want to start to identify what is it that you are looking for in a mate when you're happiest. Because people don't actually think of relationships in that light. They think of them realistically. They think of them like this, a roller coaster ride. That's not what I want you to think about when we're on a romantic evening and we're on a date. When I'm out with my wife, I don't want her thinking about whenever the finances get rough and whenever the kid's sick. No, furthest thing from that, right? And yet, where do we all go? Whenever we get in those types of situations, we all go there. So then our romantic evening gets ruined because we're not keeping the theme. The theme is we want them to think about our good stuff. Okay? So dating and romance comes down to identifying what that partner or what your potential prospect is most excited about romantically, and starting to find out if you can create the visuals to put yourself there. Okay? So just like with the hotel room, what are some situations where you have felt very romantically attached to this gentleman? Is there a moment where you can think that you were like, man, I love that guy?
I've been married 29
of those moments that just really.
I've never seen this lady.
I like it. Now what you're trying to get at here is that there's buzzwords sometimes about that people will give you. Phil, what is it you're looking for in a woman most? The first thing.
Passion.
Passion. Okay. So then when you think about passion, what does that mean to you?
A sense of being alive, a sense of being connected, a sense of participation.
Okay, good. Alive, connected, participation. And Jessica's going to be handing out some food here. I appreciate that. So the first word you said, Bill, was passion, right?
That's right.
Okay. So, now what this is called is word mapping, guys. What I asked Bill is what he's looking for most in a female, and he said passion. I said, what does passion mean to you? He said alive, connected, and participation. Okay? So what I've done now is I've created a little brain map of what Bill's looking for in a partner. Okay? So now, if I started trying to set Bill up with somebody, whether that's myself, which I won't do to you, Bill, thank you, or whether that's somebody else that I think he might be interested in, I'm going to use these words and go, Bill, I'll tell you, Mary is very passionate. She's a very passionate person. When I'm talking to her, it makes me feel alive, man, really connected to her. She's really active and participates a lot in the conversation. And do you think you'd be interested in meeting Mary?
I would.
You would be interested in meeting Mary?
Yes, I would.
Yes, I would. And see, the reason why is because I'm connecting Bill to everything good. All right, is everybody good? You got everything? So the reason that Bill says that is because I'm using his words and his brain map, okay? The thing that he said that he would be most interested in is a woman who's passionate, okay? He shows a lot of passion, makes him feel, or that's alive, connected, participation. Those are all Bill's words that he's attached to romantically. Everyone else in the room might see this and go, that means nothing to me. That does not do it for me at all. And that's why it's so important that when you're dealing with romance and relationships, that you're focusing most on what makes them light up. And you use their words.
Alive, like in breathing?
Oh,
I really hope mine's alive.
I got right. Told me that for all
the reasons. Yeah, absolutely. So if there was one thing that one trait that you would say that you find most intoxicating, most invigorating in a romantic relationship, what's the number one most important trait?
Well, you know, take those three words up there.
Alive, connected, participation, all that does it for you. That's great, man. So whenever you hear those, what kind of pictures do you get in your head? What do you think of?
Well, I'm seeing that connected, I really see committed. More than connected.
Committed sounds better to you. Yeah. So whenever you can tell that somebody is the type of person that commits, that really makes you feel like that person is somebody worth your time?
Well, if they're not committed, it's not really a very good relationship.
Exactly. So you got to make sure that they're willing to be committed first, right? So that's one of the first things that I would make sure that Lloyd knows about. Whenever I'm trying to introduce him to somebody, I'd say, listen, this person, the one thing I know about him is their commitment level. And now I'm not going to introduce him to somebody that doesn't have strong commitments. Never do that. You want to make sure that you're always fitting the right people, the right terms, and you're listening, okay? That's the most important thing, is that whenever you're trying to play matchmaker, whether it's for yourself or for someone else, you're really trying to get at what is the high point. What are the peaks? Because guys, we all have valleys. All of us do. We're all going to have valleys in our relationships. But you want to know what's the stuff that's going to get you through the valleys. What are the peaks you're looking for in another person that's going to really get you through? And whenever you find out whatever the peaks are, the things that they like to hear, the words that mean most to them, then you start to use those words most. So one of the things that I learned was in the living room one day, and you'll learn this about me the longer you're with me. Although I have pretty good people skills, I'm kind of a science nerd, and I have a tendency to be a little clinical in my responses, and not very personable, especially to this poor lady. She gets a lot of my clinical scientific talk. So one day, I'm standing in the kitchen, and she walked up to me, and she goes, "Why do you love me?" And I said, "You know, honestly, it's probably biological. There's probably a lot of chemicals there that I don't totally understand. It's the neurology. There's neuroscience behind." And I could just see her kind of glazing over her eyes, and I looked at her, and I just realized all of a sudden, I was like, "Hey, why do you love me?" And she said, "Because you're amazing." And guys, I'm not kidding you. I collapsed on the floor and started crying. And I said, "That's better. I wanted to have said that." Both of them are true, but that's better. And I want to have said that. And I learned in that instant how to respond to that question to her.
Did she ask you again now that you know the answer?
Now she asks me and she's not worried about the response, right?
Right.
Because I know which words are both truth and the right words for her. So now when I say anything to her, it's that I think you're amazing. That's a common term now in our home, is where I tell her, because it's true. A, it's easy to say, and B, she's told me that it matters. She told me when she told me that she thought I was amazing. So it's really easy to start to pick up on what other people want to hear most, because they'll say it to you most. Okay? So in relationships and in romantic situations, we want to do a good job of asking people what their peaks are and getting good about that. Getting really good about asking people what inspires them, what motivates them. What are some positive words, Robert, that you could think of that get people to elicit what it is that they get romantically interested in?
I don't understand the question.
So if I were to say, like, Jessica, what gets you most romantically interested in another person? So that's like a harsh way of asking that question. Are there any ways that you could think of to ask that question that would elicit the same type of response, but would be maybe a little more disarming?
What kind of things really, when you meet somebody, how do you know, what's that feeling you get?
Right. When you know that you want to continue talking to that person. Smell, okay? So there you go. We got somebody here with olfactory response. And one of the reasons why I always encourage speakers to keep peppermint oil around is because when you speak, you really can offend some people after you get done speaking. And so it's one of the top things that I tell people is dab a little peppermint oil on the back of your tongue when you're finished, because it will save you a bunch of clients walking away and going, "Man, he was awesome, but ooh, coffee breath sensual." So that's one of the things that I do. So I want to then, I'll say, "Well, what kind of smells do you actually enjoy? Like, what types of smells would you say that you like whenever you're around that type of smell?" Woodsy types of smells, like pine or like a campfire?
No.
So, like an Old Spice kind of guy?
So that's how you begin. So you see, like, I'm starting to ask questions when you say woodsy, outdoorsy. So you mean more like a cabin? You mean more like a chiminea? What type of smell are you thinking of?
Probably just visiting the woods, not living on it.
There you go. So then you wanna start to try to kind of find out. So that was great, actually. Just even giving me a smell was another way for you guys to see that we're not actually getting things. We're not getting actual smells. We're not getting actual sights. We're getting words. The words that we're getting is a language. The language is a code. And that code is a representation of what's in our head. So we have this thing in our head that's going on, and it's called Mentalese by Steven Pinker, who's a psychologist, doctor of psychology from Harvard. He calls it Mentalese. We have this series of pictures, thoughts, and images, and feelings that are going on in our head, and we take all of that, we code it into language, and we give it to another person. That's what I'm thinking. Well, that person will never get that exact code. They just get the word. And then they have to translate it into their own mentalese. So the most powerful way to do this is to not translate it at all. Just use their words. And allow them to draw the picture with their words. So the more I ask that question, the more I get on that stuff. So, you know, about those smells, and I'm asking those questions. Whenever we hit the end of that, that's fine. I'm going to keep everything that I got from that. Every word that she gave me, the woodsy, the outdoorsy, all that stuff, I'm going to keep it, and I'm going to use it later to bridge that gap. Okay? I'm going to maintain that feeling of positivity by reintroducing those words later on in the conversation. Okay? But I have to get them first. And the only way to get them is to be genuinely curious. You genuinely have to be curious about another person. And ask them questions that will get them into those states of positivity. You constantly want them to be thinking of those romantic thoughts. Okay? So what are some buzzwords that we automatically associate with romance? Not sex, romance. Not saying they don't go hand in hand, but we're looking for maybe both. But we're looking for romance. We're looking for, I used spice this evening in an email, and I had tons of people open. Now, it doesn't mean they clicked on it, but I'd spice it up. I'm just using the word spicy. That word right there has connotations of romance or romantic dating nature. Can we think of any other ones?
Clean is a buzzword for me.
Clean?
Clean.
Clean. There you go.
Warm was one you were using.
Warm. Spicy. Hot. Hot, right? Anything else? Sweaty. There we go. Any other words? Butterflies, getting butterflies, okay. Now we're getting somewhere because that even gives us two visuals, right? You think of the butterflies, you think of the feeling. That's great, thank you very much. Any other words? So whenever I'm interviewing someone and I'm trying to elicit the words that make them feel most in love, most romantic, most engaged like that, what type of words do you think I'm gonna use in that conversation most?
Sexy adjectives.
That's right, sexy adjectives. Really clean words, really, really hot words, really spicy words. I'm gonna be doing lots of that type of stuff. Like, whenever you're thinking of like a spicy outfit for a man to wear, or like something that looks real hot, what type of outfit is he gonna wear? How's he gonna dress? Like me, right? Because that's, she's taught me how to dress. So she's gonna dress. Yeah, right there. So, What I'm trying to get at is it doesn't matter what you're trying to find out about what that person is interested in, whether it's how the person looks, how athletic they are, how tall they are, skin color, eye color, whatever it is you're trying to get at, you want to continue to use adjectives and use phrases that keep them thinking of what they like most, not what they don't like. If you keep bringing up feelings of what that other person doesn't like, they're going to start associating you, not liking you. Okay? So the main and most important thing is that if you want to start to elicit the feelings from that other person, you have to get them to elicit their words that make them feel that feeling, that romantic feeling, and then use those words as often as possible. Okay? Because the representation in their brain will be best associated with what you want them to feel whenever. No, no problem. Thank you so much. It will start to feel best to them when you're using their code, their language that they gave you when they were thinking of their mental needs, their romantic feelings. Now, has anyone ever tried to get somebody to participate in a conversation and could tell that they were not happy? All the time, right? So then, is that the type of person that you want to try this type of technique with? Somebody who is absolutely opposed to conversation with you. You're wasting your time. Now, it's fun occasionally to get inside that person's head and find out how come they don't want to talk to you, if it was something that you did, but I'll be honest with you, if you're looking for romantic and dating types of interests, this is the last person you want to get with. Okay? Because they are not willing to even start giving you what they would want if they were thinking about it. They're not in the mood to even think about a romantic or dating type of relationship. So this always has to be something that you get consent on before you start to pursue these things, guys. It will not work without consent. You always must get somebody who's a willing participant in conversation. And if you want to learn how to obtain consent, it's super easy. It really does come down to the art of asking for permission without asking. So you say, can I ask you a question? that is not, you have not asked him a question. You've already inserted that I'm going to begin talking to you. Is that okay? Let me ask you a question. Can I ask you a question? That's consent. As long as someone says yes, you've got consent. Now, your conversation with any other person is always constantly checking that, making sure that I still have consent. That's right. Yeah, you don't want to do that. That's right. You don't want to do that number. You want to make sure that you're always getting consent. Always double checking, always making sure that it's okay to continue. Okay? And so when you start to elicit those romantic feelings, it's good to constantly start to check up and go, this is making you uncomfortable, right? We can continue. You'll find most often people, as long as you give them permission to say no and walk away, they're super happy. Robert knows this. He teaches this all the time. As long as you give people permission to walk away, normally you'll get consent more often that way. Okay? Guys, this was super short tonight. I hope that was helpful in some way. I'm going to be teaching more on this, but these workshops are really, really supposed to be just nice and fun ways of you to be able to apply this. Is there any ways that you can see that you can start to apply this information in your personal conversations? Yeah. Do you guys think that this could help you two have more romantic conversations?
How many years have you
been married? 49 years.
Because I'll tell you guys, when I discovered this, I started finding out ways of making her feel more connected to me. And it really did work. And it came down to listening more and using more of her words rather than translating them into my words and constantly getting her my words.
You just said a magic word. Listening.
Listening.
Yeah,
listening is the most important part.
Karen,
and
listening.
You have to know what to ask for first. So what I'm telling you is you have to ask questions that keep them in a state of feeling good. What makes you feel best? What makes you feel...
Two words work.
What's that?
Yes, dear.
Yes, dear.
Yes, dear. Yes, dear. And why do you think yes... dear makes people sound feel good.
Well, if mom ain't happy, nobody's happy.
That's right. So whenever you hear yes when you're trying to sell a car, how do you think it makes somebody feel?
Yes.
When you're trying to say, when you get a yes whenever you're trying to convince your partner or somebody that you care about to do something good for them, how does it make you feel? Yeses make us feel great, right? Mm-hmm. Yes, dear is a fantastic way of gaining that because it brings those good feelings, okay? And that's just another example. You want to constantly elicit those good feelings, so everything you do is about turning the conversation to what makes you feel best. Okay? And whenever you're dealing in romance, you want to find out what makes them feel most romantically connected to you, or else you're losing. Because the more you can get them to maintain that state, that emotional high state of being connected to you, committed to you, attracted to you, the more you can do that, and that's the theme. That's the story. That's what they're going to take away from their relationship with you. So we want to do, even though our relationships are constantly doing this, we want to focus on the piece. And we want to find which words from each individual person around us that we care about, which words are their peak words. And those are the ones we need to repeat most often. Peak words, and stay away from the valleys. Okay? All right, thank you guys. I really appreciate it. Thank you for coming, and give yourself a hand, because you guys helped me a lot. Thank you. Please eat. We're just going to hang out now.
Looks like I got a finger in your pie, too, sir.